Hey everybody, it's Vallen from Mischief of Mice, here with another Bit by Bit on Thaumcraft. Today, we're covering a whole lot of stuff. Let's see. Nodes. Alright, here we are with the basics on nodes, and we're going to work through into some really advanced stuff. So, first, we got to see what we're doing. I'm putting on my goggles of revealing. Alright, there we go. Now we can see the nodes for what they are. So, these and all nodes in the world, in the overworld, will provide V, which you can use your wand to drain from. You can also scan it with your thermometer and gain research points. And you can get ethereal essence from it by breaking it. Right now, I'm just using this to keep it from others. But there you go. You can get ethereal essence, which you can use for different recipes and so on. Now that you know what all the nodes can do, let's get into more specifics. There's different powers and types. Starting with the powers, going from weakest to strongest, this is the speed at which the V in a node will actually replenish itself. If you have a fading node, which you'll see here it says normal fading, then that means any V that you absorb from it with your wand will not come back. It just stays there. See, that one now is no longer going to get any higher than 26. Not unless you do some special advanced techniques, which we might get into later. But know that fading is probably the weakest regen you can get and nothing that you really want to go back to again because you can't get any more from it. Next is the pale node. You'll notice here it says pale. What that means is it's just got a slow V regen on it. So if I absorb some of this, it will slowly come back. Now yeah, it did come back real quick for that one bit, but it's just going to be very slow for the rest of it. Third in the list is a normal node. Now you notice here it just says normal, and as this one said normal as well, it won't actually say normal normal. So it's kind of implied. But it does have a normal V regen on it. And then you've got bright. Bright, as it says here, bright, will have the highest V regen. So, of course, this is desired, especially with a lot of aspects on it. So you could constantly keep coming back to it and taking aspects into your wand as needed. And then it would replenish those very quickly. Now you're not going to see them going too quickly right now because of these stabilizers I have underneath them right now are keeping them at a slow pace regardless. The next kind that we have is the different types of nodes. Now you saw the different regen powers of the nodes. Now we go into the different kinds of nodes. A normal one is your most basic. There are no special attributes. Just says normal. Now this one is bright, but that reflects the speed at which the V in it replenishes. Next up, we have the hungry node, which you may remember from previous episodes. This is basically a big swirling vortex of doom, sort of like a black hole in a way. It will pull you in, eat you and anything else up. As you've noticed, it's destroyed the landscape around it. It will also absorb aspects on it. Now, I am currently in creative mode, so I am unaffected by the gravitational vacuum or whatever this thing uses on it. But, just so you can see, it has a lot of aspects on it. That's because it's been sucking in different items and adding to it. This can make it very strong for replenishing your wand, but very dangerous because it could also eat you and all your items in it. Then we have the sinister node. Now this is beneficial and negative. You don't want one of these things inside your base, that's for sure. Reason being, it actually will create an eerie biome around it. That's why I've got these ethereal blooms nearby, just to offset that. Otherwise, the entire area would be an eerie biome at this point. But it also is a furious zombie mob spawner. So you could use it as a mob spawner to kill things and harvest the goods that they drop, but otherwise, it's just a dangerous thing, but can be used to absorb the aspects, of course. If you have a mapping program, then you might actually be able to see on your minimap the darker areas, which would be sinister nodes. I've got some there, I've got one here, So therefore, it'd be easy to find it on a minimap, but otherwise, you just look for the dark area, darker than usual squares as you're exploring the area that you're in. Then we've got the pure node. Now the pure node, let me get a little closer here, can be found in a couple ways. One is on occasion, you may find them in the core of a silverwood tree. And therefore, there you go. Not many aspects are usually found on them, especially in a silverwood tree, but you can also find them in the wild. Here is one here that is not in a tree. Now, if you do end up chopping one of those trees down and you take out the section of wood that has the node in it, you will destroy the node as well, so keep that in mind. Last and definitely not least is going to be the tainted node. Now, this here is quite possibly one of the most dangerous. Not only because it's not going to eat you like the hungry node would, or suck you in, or create mobs per se, it will end up destroying the biome that you're in, and will spread over time. So if you're close to one of these, you may be in danger. What will happen is it will spread this taint, which will then constantly create monsters and a poisonous ground for you to walk on, that even if you're on it for too long, will hurt you, as well as the mobs that it creates from regular world spawns. It will then spread to other areas, and as it spreads, if it runs into other aura nodes, it will then taint them, and spread even further and further. So even if you destroy this node, it will not stop everything. The taint will still remain. So what you'll have to do is take other measures, which we may discuss later on with the ethereal blooms. That pretty much sums up the different types and powers of the nodes, but we're still not done yet. We're going into how to move one so that you can have it for your own personal use without having to go into creative mode. Of course, I'm going to stay in creative mode just for demonstration purposes anyway. But the node in a jar. Right here on the very first page, your basic information, you could research it, and it tells you here how to create it. Just a 3x3 of glass around a node, with some wood slabs on the top and a lot of V in your wand. And you tap it, and therefore it will create one of these, a little node in a jar. Pretty cool. And then you can transport it around in your inventory, take it with you. Here, I'll actually pick it up. And you can see I can just walk around with it, place it down, which because I'm in creative, it just creates a duplicate of it. And you just can pick it back up again, and it's good. So, how do you create one of these and how is it useful? Well, we'll get to that in a second. First, you need to know that there's a 75% chance to drop a power level. So, for instance, this one here is a normal node. And what that means is that there's a 75% chance it will become pale, which is not good. It's going to end up being a slower regen on it. You definitely want bright ones if you can get them with a lot of aspects and so on, but then again, any node is better than no node, so you may still want to take it anyway and risk things. Plus, there are ways of improving its regen power, but we'll discuss that later. It's limited to its current stats, so if I take a wand and I suck this thing dry down to all ones on there, and then I capture it, there's a very good chance that those are going to be the new maximum stats on this thing when I re-break it and put it into the world. So you're going to want to make sure that this thing is fully recharged before you end up capturing it and moving it. It's portable until you break it, which you can, as I showed you before, which it's going to do the same thing again. Let me get rid of that version. But you place it, and then you can just left-click it or dig it with a item or weapon or whatever, and you can pick it back up. Real easy to do. But it's also expensive, so you're going to need to use some kind of silverwood wand with a lot of V in it in order to be able to do that to begin with. And I often want to do that as often as possible and get a whole lot of them around you, which I will go over in a second. But before we get that far, let's finish building this thing so that you can see what it looks like. Wood. All right, and that's what it'll look like when it's done. Now, to convert it into a node in a jar, let me just take that off of there. You just right-click it with a wand, and pow, there you go. Now let's check it out. Oh, we got lucky. It stayed as a normal node instead of dropping a level. So we hit that 25% chance of it staying the way it is. Pretty cool. Then you can just pick it up. And even not being in creative, you just punch it a bunch of times and you'll pick it up. Same as any of the Essentia jars. And then you can put it down where you want. Put it here. Let's get rid of that one. And then you take a wand and you right-click it. And it breaks it. And it is therefore in place where you want it to be. Pretty neat. And there are some dangers with that, though. If you put one node close enough to another node, they will actually start devouring one another, or one will devour the other, rather. It's called bullying. And if it's within five blocks, so one, two, three, four, five. If it is here, it's safe. But if it's right there, the two nodes are going to start having a battle, and one of the two is going to win. That can be beneficial, but not always. Especially when you're first starting out. Often you just want a whole bunch of these around so that you can drain the aspects from them as often as you can so that you can get your wand back up, make more stuff, use them for different focuses or foci, etc. Well, that's what we're going to get into next, is how to get them really close together. But before you do, how do you use them all like this in order to recharge your wand? Well, a wand recharge pedestal, of course. Grab your Thaumonomicon, and on the Thaumaturgy page, top left corner, is where all the good stuff is. We're going to be going over most of this. We've got the, there it is, wand recharge pedestal, right there. And it's a little expensive to make, but you only need to make one, really. I mean, you can make a few if you need to, but I found one is more than sufficient most of the time, at least when you're first starting out on this. And what happens is you just put your wand in there, and you see this one's already fully charged. It's a really powerful wand, but it will actually pull up to 8 blocks away. Now, if you don't include this pedestal, and you don't include where the node is, then it's 7 blocks between, just to give you an idea of how far it goes out. So what I have set up right now, let me turn the lights out so you guys can see it a little easier, is currently a giant cube of how far that thing can reach. And none of these are currently, none of the nodes are able to bully each other because of the distance that they're at. And this is the maximum spread you can have without actually using stabilizers to keep them from bullying each other, which we'll do stabilizers in just a moment. Because right now, there is other ways of upgrading this. But let's put something on here that needs a charge. Here we go, I just used this to make a node in a jar. So let's put that in there. And you'll see it starts pulling aspects from, there it goes, way bottom corner, all these different nodes. And it's going to do them one at a time, one aspect at a time. You can see it slowly recharging these things. But let's say I have some nodes here with multiple aspects that are of no use. Right here, we've got Bestia on there. Well, what good is Bestia going to do if I only have 6 aspects on a wand? Well, that's where your compound recharge focus comes in. On the Thaumonomicon, right over here, you make one of these things, I'd highly recommend you do it as soon as you make yourself a wand recharge station. Reason being is you're not always going to have the resources you need, especially when you're first capturing the nodes to set them up. And this will make things a lot easier. You just right-click it on there. Oh, there we go. Sorry, my aim is really bad. You right-click it on the top, and you get yourself a new station. And what it's going to do is it's going to break up different aspects like, yeah, you see here, it's taking vitreous. Vitreous is not one of the primal aspects. Well, it is in this case because it breaks it down into its primal makeup. So if you remember using a research table, you would take a couple aspects and combine them together to make a more complex aspect. That's what this is doing in the reverse. It's breaking the aspects back down, the more complex ones, like Vitreous or Bestia, and using them as primal aspects, thus recharging your wand. Pretty darn cool stuff there. I really do like it. And therefore, you can just switch your wands out, I recommend having two wands, and then you'll always be able to have one in the stand and the other one that you're using. Makes it really simple. But there are even more advanced ways of taking care of this solution so that you don't have to use such a massive area for recharging your wand. This is just one example without getting too technical except for the core here. So let's get into the next section. And that is node stabilizers. Node stabilizers, they prevent bullying in or out. You make one of those here on the Thaumnomicon here. They're not too bad to make, they are redstone usable. But if you place a node, which I will put one right on top of this just so I can show you. There we go. If you put a node on there and break it, or put this underneath an existing node, it will then create this little dome around it. And what that does is, one, it will prevent another node nearby that is within the 5-block radius from bullying it, and two, it will prevent another node nearby from being bullied by it. Now, it also has a third effect, and that is it will slow your recharge of it will slow your node's recharge speed. So it's something to keep in mind. I mean, if you have a whole bunch of these together in one room, then that's great. It'll make it really easy for you to recharge your wand and so on. But if you have them spread out like this so that they don't interact with each other, they'll recharge actually a bit faster than they would if they were in one of these. Now, there isn't just the standard stabilizer. Oh no, there's an advanced one, which is, here we go, advanced. You take a normal one, infuse it as such, and you end up getting yourself one of these. The difference is, it may upgrade a fading to a pale. And in case you forgot, the fading, which I have over here, will have no V regen. So let's say you take a pale one and you capture it, and you bring it, and when you capture it in the jar, it turns into a fading. Oh dear. Well, that's not going to be any good. The most I could do then is use it to feed another node, which we'll get into shortly. Not so much. There is a chance that it might upgrade your fading to a pale node. So that's something worth stating. But also, this has special abilities, which allows it to bully other nodes, but not being bullied. Well, what good is that? Well, let's say I want, let's see here, a pure bright node, so that it's very strong regen. It's a pure one, so you know it's not going to have any negative effects on it. But it doesn't have very high V numbers on it. They're very low. And I put it next to, let's say, a sinister node with much higher stats. Well, the sinister node would end up bullying it, unless you have it on one of these. This allows a weaker, or stronger, if that's the case, node from being bullied by others, but it allows it to bully the other nodes. So this is basically your way of making the node that you want to make. Why would you want a bigger node? Because the returns from feeding one to another usually aren't that good. Well, let me go into further detail on that. Here we are, back at the home base. I'm sure some of you remember this node that I had in a previous run here, that I was feeding a whole bunch of other nodes around it. Well, you see, it's got a ton of aspects on it. Look at that list on the right, plus all those little icons on it. It's ridiculous. This thing is going to be really good. Well, not so much. I mean, look, it's got 36 aqua, 67 terra. I mean, those are just standard for some singular nodes. I could just get a bunch of regular nodes. The reason I'm saying this is because I fed this thing probably a good 30, 40 nodes before it got this way. And that wasn't very effective feeding, though. Oh, no. That was very ineffective. I just plunked a whole bunch of nodes around it and let the strongest node win, which happened to be this one, which is also just a normal node. It's not bright or anything like that. Well, that is kind of a bad method of going about it. There are a couple ways of really getting a good node that is going to be good for you, and I'm going to go into detail on that. First and foremost is to feed one safely, but really tediously, and that is to take a node in a jar, most likely, place it within range of the node that you want, probably on an advanced stabilizer there so that you can make sure that it does not get bullied, and place it within 5 blocks. Well, the closer it is, the faster it's going to end up eating it. So if you put it way over here, it's going to be a little bit slow. That could be good, could be bad, depending upon what you want to do. But you see all these aspects on it and how high they are, that's really good. What you don't want to happen is this to absorb all the aspects on that and bring it down to all zeros. You'll want to shut it off with the shut off the stabilizer you have on this one, which let's just spawn one in. Here we go. We'll put that right underneath. And it automatically turns on, forms the dome, and it will slowly start eating this one. Well, let's get one that's a little bit closer actually. There we go. We'll just get rid of that one. And this one here has 3 good aspects on it. You see it's starting to eat it. It's actually going really quick. What you want to do is get yourself a lever of some sort and make sure that you can shut this off. So that if this gets too low, you shut it off, let this thing recharge. Whoops, not shut it off. Put a regular stabilizer underneath this one. Actually, let me get that stabilizer. Sorry, I'm kind of talking backwards here. Get you a stabilizer with one of these. Now this one you're probably not going to want to turn off at all. You can, might as well just keep it on. But this one here, when it gets too low, you can turn it on and it will therefore protect it from being bullied by another one. But when you want this one to bully it, you turn it off and let it go for a bit. You could probably set some kind of timer up to turn back on after so long. But keep in mind that when this is up, it's not being bullied, but it's also slower recharge than a standard node. Even if it's a bright node, it will still be slower because it's on a stabilizer. So that's one way of creating one giant master node, which I will go into more detail at the end of this as to why you'd want to do that. But for now, let's just go on to the second method, which is much more interesting in my opinion. That is a hungry node. Now, once again, I'm in creative mode, so do not do this unless you have other means of escaping. But a hungry node here. This one is, let's look at the aspects on it. It's got some really good aspect numbers because it's been eating a lot of stuff. I have been feeding it a little bit too. Let's get some of these items here. I'm going to feed it crafting tables. This is probably one of your best items you can feed it. It's a renewable resource, constantly gets you aspects. You always want your primal aspects on it because those are going to get you the best numbers if possible. Plus, those are the ones that you're going to want to use anyway. But if I start feeding this thing, just watch those numbers there. You see Aqua just went up. Keep feeding that. Ignis just went up. Aqua again. The more I feed this, the more it's going to actually increase. And this is the maximum on this, that it's going up. Let me actually turn it back to dark again. So why would I ever want to stop? Well, you got to at some point. But it's also a hungry node, so it's dangerous. You get too close to it and you're going to get sucked in and die and lose all your stuff, especially your really expensive and awesome Thaumian boss primal staff. Well, there are ways of actually avoiding death. And there are ways of converting this to your advantage, because you still can use this to absorb. Let's see if I actually have a, here we go, this one's a bit low, a wand here. You can absorb the aspects from it, you know, even if it's a hungry node, and therefore you can protect yourself from it and still use it as is, or you can convert it. That's what we're going to get into. So to capture one of these, you're going to need some obsidian. So let's go over to this other hungry node that I have here. And this one here, I have partially encased in obsidian, just like the node in a jar. So let's get rid of this. Actually, let me grab a couple other items here that I don't need in my inventory. And we're going to finish this build. You see this one here, it's currently a hungry, bright node. That's really good. And it's got some aspects on it, but not many. Well, you can continue feeding it, automating, launching items into it, having them dropped into it from a high area. But what I recommend if you're going to end up trying to capture one of these is get yourself some obsidian and a whole bunch of ender pearls, plus some way of of flight would be best if possible, like a thermostatic harness or so on. But we're not getting into making one of those today. Once you've got those, if you start taking damage from this, then you can actually use the underpearl, toss it out there, and get yourself away from it quickly. But for now, we're just going to do this. Now, if you build it like this, it is therefore safe, unless you have some kind of mod that allows you to get into one-by-one spaces. But with this, it will still destroy blocks near this opening, except for obsidian. Now, you notice the wood blocks that I have on top are actually undamaged because the obsidian is a shield from it, but it is still going to suck me in. Here, let me demonstrate by changing my game mode to zero. You can see I'm still being sucked into this thing right now, whether I want to or not. I mean, I can still kind of move myself around a little bit, and it tends to try and, you know, it's still holding on to me. But let's go back into game mode one. There we go. And what you can do now is feed it, whether from the top or bottom, side, whatever. I recommend the sides because you're going to be too big to fit in, whereas the top or bottom, you could still get sucked into it and die. And therefore, if you're caught without some way of teleporting or getting away from it very fast, then you'd be, well, in trouble. There are many mods that will increase your speed so that you're fast enough to get away. There are also many mods that allow you extra teleportation. But with just Thaumcraft, your thermostatic harness, maximum haste, and everything, you're still not going to be able to get away that way. So I do recommend the underpearls as a good backup. But once you're done feeding it, let's say you want to convert it. Well, you can get yourself a bottle of taint. Now, how do you get a bottle of taint? That's in your Thaumnomicon. I don't think it's under here either. Alchemy. There we go. Right there. Bottled taint. Now what this is going to do, I'm actually going to go down a couple. Toss it here. And it will actually taint the area. Yeah, I got a little bit of taint poison on myself in the process. But it will taint the area, and that will spread. And eventually, it will get to the... you don't actually have to encase it at this point. I would recommend actually leaving it open a bit. But it will then get to the node, turn it from a hungry node into a tainted node, which can be bad, don't get me wrong. But once this has been energized, it will then lose its environmental hazards, whether it's tainted or hungry. But if you try energizing a hungry node, you'll probably lose your gear. If you try energizing a tainted node, you just get a little taint in the area that you can clean up afterwards. So I recommend the tainted approach. Now this will take quite some time for it to happen. So we're just gonna walk away from that. And now we're going to get into, another method, because you notice I have encased it in obsidian. If you don't want to go with this taint method, I don't think I scanned that yet. There we go. If you don't want to use the taint method, you don't have to. You can keep it as a hungry node and try your chances with using energizing gear on this, which, as I said, I'll go into in a second. What you end up doing here is, let's see, we're going to need a certain wand focus of equal trade. And then we're going to need glass. I'm going to put down a piece of glass. And then we're going to tell it. Oops, I just realized. There we go. Might help if I actually put the right wand in my hand when I do that. There we go. So you see in the top left corner, the wand of equal trade works this way. It will exchange blocks without breaking them. So problem is, if I use glass originally around a hungry node, it will absorb the glass. But if you're quick enough, you can use a wand of equal trade to turn all the obsidian into glass and quickly contain it in a bottle. So that's what we're going to try and do here. Ready? And there we go. We now have a hungry node in a jar. Pretty neat stuff. So I'm going to leave that there for now, though. You can actually move that as well to a safer location if you desire. But for now, we're just going to go over here and explain what the heck I'm talking about with energizing. Energizing a node involves a node transducer, which actually is up here. There we go. Node transducer, this item up here on top of a node, which for those that don't know, if you have a node, you can actually build on top of it, just like that, or next to it, and so on. It's detectable when building, but you can walk through it. But a node transducer, you just plop one of those on top while you've got a stabilizer or an advanced stabilizer on the bottom, and you'll need to give it a redstone signal. Its default setting is off. So you put it on top of a node, or you put it in place and then you add a node later, and then you turn it on and it will start energizing the node. Now, what does that mean? Well, essentially, allow me to get rid of that. We don't want that. And actually, I think this needs a recharge. So, you take a block of redstone is my preference, or you could use a lever, whatever you like. Put it on top. You see it starts coming down, and it will start activating. And there were a few aspects in there. Should have given you a look beforehand, but sorry about that. And it will, over time, convert those aspects, in this case, Ignis, Aqua, and, I can't remember the last one, Vinculum, I think, into a constant flow of those aspects instead of just a charge and then you have to come back to it later. So here's one that I have that's already done. And it is currently got Ordo and Terra. And you notice there's only five. Well, it had a lot more on that. It actually divides it by like 10 or something, or a square root. I can't remember the exact math behind it. But it will definitely drop the number on there. Now, you'd think, well, what good is 5 going to be? Well, if you take a wand, let's see here, one that I have that's not very full. There we go. This one's just got 8 in it. And keep in mind, it only has Ordo and Terra in it. So if I end up accessing this, and I put this wand in the table, which I should say, there is a V recharge relay in there. And that is right here. Made as such with a V relay. Pretty simple stuff. You put it on top of an arcane work table, and by doing so, you end up putting something in here, and you notice it's actually increasing those numbers. It's a little fluctuating because the it's going back and forth on decimal points. But you see how quickly those aspects are regenerating. I mean, yes, it's decimals, but it's a constant flow. It never runs out, so you don't have to worry about it. You just leave it in the table, and it will slowly regenerate. And the strongest or highest aspect that it's using at the time will be the color of the beam that it's using. So that's pretty darn cool. Now, what happens if I turn one of these off? Well, danger. So keep in mind, once you've got this set up, you really don't want to do it. You can reverse it by shutting this off and waiting a while for it to convert back to a regular one. But if you do it otherwise, keep in mind, bad things will happen. Lots of flux going everywhere, explosion, you might lose things. The part on the top blew off, but that was, I think, because I broke it in a creative manner. So it won't work anymore as well. That's pretty bad. But, I mean, it's very useful once you get it in place. Now, you see this one here is actually finished, and it's got a lot of aspects on it. It's got 5 of the 6 aspects. That's actually amazing. Now, what it'll do for those aspects on it, like in this one, it's got census. It will actually convert census into primal aspects. So if it's got a whole bunch of weird aspects on it, like the main one does back at the house, then it will actually end up converting them into base aspects, like this one did. And therefore, you can hook it up to one of those. Now, you notice the distance, it didn't go very far. Well, it only goes about, 8 blocks or so. So we're going to grab some of these, and we're going to drop this on here. I've already got one of those. And then we're going to take another wand. There we are. And put it in here. And you can see that one is recharging as well. Now, let's say that this is actually much further away than I thought. Let's take this back out. Oops. I'll grab that in a second. There we are. Let's say that I need it way over here. And I ended up energizing a node a little further away than I thought. Well, I don't want to shut this thing down. What do I do? Well, that's when you can use some extra bits here. Oh, I left it over there. You're going to want a V relay. And let me spawn one in here. There we go. And what that does is within 8 blocks of the node, it will, and also within view, allow it to transport along to the table. And therefore, let's take that one, this one here. There you go. It's now charging. And you can have it powering multiple tables if you like. Oops. Let's put another wand in here. And you can see it's actually still going. Now it's going to slow it down, splitting the amount. You see that the beam here is really strong, the beam there is really weak. If I take my goggles off, it's very difficult to see the beams at all. So that's more an aesthetic thing that you'll probably see more like that. So by energizing a hungry node that you fed up to like 1,000 of each type, you could really get some massive returns. Or in the case of back at my base here, we're going to energize this little guy here. So let me grab, I'm going to grab a few things, and when I'm ready to go, I'll be right back. Here we are, and I'm going to turn it into a node in a jar. There we go, and oh no, it turned pale. Well, there are ways around that. Allow me to explain before we move this. And that involves my next area that I've got, a little bit over here. For advanced users in the Thaumcraft, under the Eldritch tab, there is a little thing called a primordial pearl. Now this here, once you've learned how to make it, be aware that when you use it on a node, an explosion will happen. Flux will happen. But it has a 50% chance of turning a faded one into pale, and a 50% chance of turning a pale one into a normal node, 20% chance of turning a normal into a bright. Now this is after you move it. So you got to be careful when you put that where you want it to be, that it doesn't blow your stuff up. I am going to leave that one as is, but I've got one here that says 27 and 52. Here we go. I'm going to apply primordial pearl. This one remained a normal. It was normal before, but it actually gained some aspects. So there is an advantage to using one of those pearls. I'm going to try again and we'll see what happens. And there we go. Normal bright. I guess third time wasn't a charm, it was the fourth. Well, you see it actually added on some aspects to it, which is beneficial, but I don't think those are going to get higher than maybe 2 or 3 at most once they're done recharging, if they recharge at all. So that is one way of upgrading, but you see, whoops, you can see the mess that I made in the process. A lot of flux, a lot of flux. Oh dear, lots of bad stuff going around. So that's something that's a little bit messy. But like I said, I'm not going to do that with mine. I'm just going to keep it as the node that it is. And we are going to place it in the house. In here, in the elevator here. And there we go. That looks just right to me. And we're going to place it. And you can see the aspects are actually being drained while it's being energized. That's going to take quite a while because there's a lot of aspects in there, but it will in the end turn into an energized node and power my little workstations I have down here. So while it's doing that, I'm going to pause this and we'll be back shortly. And there we have it. It is now energized. Look down here. I have the V relays attached to the altar, but I think it's a little too far. So let's add... Oh, I already have one. My bad. Let's add one right here. And there we go. I now have quite a bit going on. Now these are already full, so let's put something in here that's pretty much empty and find out what happens. Wow, that's charging up really fast. Now, of course, one, two, three. I mean, that's how fast it's charging all the aspects. So, I mean, it is rather slow. You did see it wasn't especially great. It was around like 50 or so for the normal aspects. And it didn't convert to a whole lot in the end. But that was because it wasn't fed properly. So if you want to, I personally recommend... Let me out. Going the route of the hungry node, because it's the most challenging, the most fun, and the least tedious. You have to build some kind of device to automatically feed it for you. Plus, moving it can be quite interesting and dangerous and very rewarding in the end. I mean, converting 1,000 down to, let's say, it would turn it into about 100 instead of the previous 50 down to 5 is a big, big difference on the recharge rate. Plus, you can use energized nodes to do more than just recharge your wands. There's a lot that these can power, but we're not getting into that because I think we are at the finishing point of today's episode. So, if you guys enjoyed it, please give me a like, comment, or subscribe, and until next time, see ya!